From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
My name is Jennifer Harpster. I'm a digital reference specialist for the Library of Congress. I'd like to welcome you to today's program, a Mars update, in which we're going to learn about NASA's latest Mars findings and exploration strategy. This program is a series of programs in 2010 that's presented through a partnership with the NASA Goddard Space Flight Center and our division. And this is our fourth year partnering with Goddard. Our speaker today is Dr. James Garvin, and he is currently the chief scientist of the Sciences and Exploration Directorate office at Goddard. Dr. Garvin received his bachelor's degree in Earth and Planetary Sciences at Brown University and a master's of science from Stanford. He returned to Brown to earn a Ph.D. in Planetary Geological Sciences and then joined Goddard in 1984. He has received numerous awards and honors for his work, which include the NASA Outstanding Leadership Medals for his work with the Mars Exploration Program and the Rover Mission, the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter, and the Mars Science Lab. Without a doubt, his research has been instrumental to our knowledge of all things Mars. So much so that he's been on The Late Show with David Letterman, and various Discovery channels sharing his knowledge of Mars with the general public. But his research not only revolves around Mars, it also includes lunar exploration, Venus, asteroids, and outer planets. I recently read that Dr. Garvin is investigating the future of Venus exploration. And perhaps he'll come back to give us some insight into that planet. But today we're going to focus on Mars. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Dr. James Garvin.
Oops, thanks everyone. Well, ooh, a little loud. So let's turn our eyes on the planet Mars, and today I hope I can express for you what it's like to be living a scientific revolution. Now, maybe you've all heard about them. They were a big thing back in the Renaissance. But right now, we're not in the Renaissance, maybe a new Renaissance. And so I want to explain how we see Mars changing. And it's an incomplete picture. It's really a masterpiece unfinished because the flood of information we've achieved over the last decade is really unprecedented. For those of you that are keeping stock, the libraries of knowledge about the planet Mars are slowly but surely catching up with the great storehouse of knowledge here at the Library of Congress. So please come in, folks. Mars won't bite. It's a little dusty, but sorry about that. So I'm going to try to give you a perspective on what we are learning. It's incomplete. Forgive me if I say this is what we think, because science works in strange ways and using multiple working hypotheses. I once spoke to some young students, and they asked me, What is it that draws you to this kind of thing? Why are you all here thinking about it? And it's really it's never useful to wait to wonder, and Mars helps us to wonder. So let me start with A Tale of Two Planets, to borrow from Dickens a little bit. And really, we have interest in Mars because it reminds us of home. It's a destination that is tangible enough to be viewed by all of us here, all of us out there, as a frontier. And that's part of our psyche, of our culture, here in the United States at least, and I think throughout the world. So really, the Mars Exploration Program that was restructured just a decade ago, and I was privileged enough to be involved in that restructuring, is all about taking advantage of the discovery potential. It's kind of like a business plan. We do our market analysis, we see what we're going to get. Here we're looking at Mars, and the market analysis says we're going to learn a lot. And this is really directly coupled to the big questions, the ennobling questions we ask about the universe. And a lot of people ask me, why do we care about space? We live here on Earth. Well, I have to remind you all, the planet Earth lives in space, so does Mars, and so do we. So to ignore where we live is somewhat, sometimes a little bit limiting. So while we think about Mars, we think about what we're learning about Earth. And of course, we're all very aware of global environmental change. Mars has done it bigger and better, and so it may be a lesson to us. So let me start my lecture then with, after that preamble, with really the big question. So why do we explore beyond Earth? Well, there's a lesson in what we've witnessed over the last 40 years about our planet. This kind of event is fairly commonplace. And to speak simply, single planet species don't survive. Single island species don't survive. So whether we're Martians or we're going to Mars, maybe Mars is the lesson for us. So think about that as we look at what we're learning about our red planet. Now, some of you have heard, come on in, folks. There's plenty of Mars here. I think there's a chair over here. We can move that one there, maybe. Sorry about that. So I don't know if that one's taken, but what do I know? In any event, one of the things that draws us to Mars is the lure of this magic molecule, water, the universal solvent, critical as to life as we understand it here on Earth, perhaps essential. We can debate that in questions. But the history of understanding whether Mars had water is really a checkered pathway of dry lunar Mars transitioning into a Mars that apparently had enough water to fit in thimbles, still a polar, sterile, dry desert, into the Mars we now see. And if you look in the lower right, you can just see one of the many new findings made possible by the Mars Exploration Program that shows us Mars is a water planet. It's just the water isn't as obvious. That's an important thing, because as we understand the history of life on our planet, its ability to find niches and wait for the right times to be productive, as life likes to be, depends on activation of water, like you see in the little crater down in the bottom. So we're discovering the history of water as we get to know an extremely dynamic world. Just 30 years ago, during the era, 35 years ago to be sadly true, during the era of the Viking missions to Mars, we thought of Mars after years of working, searching for the tendrils of life, as a polar, sterile desert. Superoxidants galore, not a good place to live. Sort of auto-sterilizing. That really set people back. Now, we geologists, of course, have hope. We think in long timescales. We kept at it, many, many people here. And now the Mars we're seeing, thanks to this new program, is dynamic, changing in front of our eyes, changing in ways that do speak better for the history and the possibility of life. Now, here's a little chart that summarizes the exploration strategy for Mars that NASA and the science community put together about a decade ago. Because about a decade ago, we had just lost two Mars missions, the Mars Climate Orbiter, the Mars Polar Lander. This was a tremendous setback. It was really disarming to all of us that like to explore Mars that we got it wrong. What's wrong? Well, what was wrong was not thinking clearly about how to do Mars. And now our robotic program is the envy of all. We even scored, I'm proud to say, in the various metrics done by our government as one of the highest ranked programs in the entire federal government 2003-2004 in terms of productivity for the taxpayer dollar. And they have units and metrics that I let them explain to you, but we did score well, apparently, you know, better than many things on the web, so that's good. So anyway, the strategy is very simple. Understand things that are elements or aspects of what may be how we understand life, and do it through the lens of biological potential. That means, could it have been? Not, we know it's there, we found it. You know, if we wait for the little crawling cyanobacteria bug to crawl in front of the microscope in our hand, we may be waiting a long time. We have to think smarter. And finding the building blocks of life, or the leftover remnants of that, may be a better strategy. And that's how we've looked at Mars. And we see, through what we're learning from orbit and from the surface and from meteorites we believe to have come from Mars, this strategy is good. And it's borne fruit. This is just a few covers of some scientific journals, prestigious ones many of us like to read. And it just shows a few, actually, the last couple years in the life of Mars. So the Mars Exploration Program at NASA is a scientific envy of many because it's been so productive. We've seen aspects in these pictures of the water story, the ice story, the climate change story. All this stuff 15 years ago was, we didn't think that was the way it was going to be. Mars was a geological fossil planet. All the action was 4 billion years ago, 3.5, numbers that have lots of zeros. The other reason we explore Mars is perhaps summarized here. Because as we explore as people, and I know this is philosophical, so forgive me this one moment, it's all about the mystery. The journey with mystery is good. We have mystery shows on TV. People like it. CSI does Mars is a thought. Maybe not, but for those of you that watch that, please. So the mysteries in the past are, you know, our predecessor people thought of them as miracles. Shooting stars, my God, someone's mad at us. You know, the gods are coming down, the sky is falling. And now we see them as questions we can ask through technology, through scientific quests. And ultimately, Mars gives us the first good shot, other than through astrophysics, looking beyond our local solar system, of asking the question intelligently, with well-informed intentions, are we alone? So let's look at history for a minute, if you don't mind. So in the 1950s, after the heyday of the Second World War and the scientific revolution described by Vannevar Bush, we thought we'd be going to Mars this way. You know, Buck Rogers does Mars, Collier's Magazine, great drawings, I wish I could draw so well. And it turned out, as most of the things predicted in the late 40s and early 50s, not to be that way. It turned out to be the armada of the robots. And we went vicariously on the photons. In fact, we rode the photons to Mars and rode them back into our minds to generate knowledge. And this is just a rogues gallery of some of the things we've been doing. The Vikings, the little Mars Global Surveyor, that's not MGS in your food, and many other things you'll see here. And we have plans beyond those here for even more. The robotic armada to Mars continues, because what we can say now that we know definitively is still a teacupful. We're still in kindergarten in Mars, and we've got to get into high school if we're going to seriously think about sending ourselves there in person, which is a quest that many of us believe is very important. So the Mars that we got to know is very different than the experience we had with the first humans off planet. You know, it's hard to imagine the last second that humanity, women or men, left the protective sheath of the Earth system was in 1972. There has not been one organism we've sent intentionally to deep space since then. We went to the moon, there's Apollo 17, really cool place, Taurus Littrow, and below is Mars, and there's yours truly, looking for Mars on Earth. It's still a quest we have to try to understand this other world. But I show this picture, with me as a grad student, looking a lot better then, I guess. I show it to you to tell you that even going to places that have some of the physics and chemistry of Mars, we're still not there. It does not read our textbooks, and we have to bear witness to that. So the revolution in Mars started in roughly 1997, 1998, when this little desktop refrigerator scale spacecraft known as the Mars Global Surveyor started pounding the bits, the photons, back to Earth. And in the midst of losing two missions, this mission showed us Mars has more to offer. It's topographically dynamic. That expresses itself in the history of the crust of the planet. That's big stuff. We find remnant signatures, I'll show you in a minute, of the fact that Mars had a magnetic field, perhaps Earth scale in magnitude. And then it lost it. How does a planet do that, you might ask? So do we. We found evidence of minerals on the surface that connote water, at least under Earth conditions we would expect to find them in environments where water had been present. We found changing features that could tell us of the pace of climate change on Mars and its atmosphere. Who would have thought, as I tell you this is pretty scary, that 25% about of the Mars atmosphere freezes out every year and then is re-released into the atmosphere. Imagine that happening on Earth. Our weather would be different. Let me say that. Just imagine. For those of you who are meteorologists, you can imagine. So we've seen the storms. We've watched them as if we were there through the eyes of the Global Surveyor and now our other orbiters. And you can see a regional dust storm spiraling off the mid-latitudes of Mars and growing. It's the backwards J or comma-like thing there, scale of sort of Texas, for those of you from Texas. Pretty big there. We watch these things. We see the near global dust storms as they come, starting to become predictive. We can ask and know when these things are going to happen and avoid the bad times. And then this funny-looking map, you might say, why is he showing me this boring thing? This is actually big stuff, because this shows the fossil record of the magnetic field of Mars and the rocks. And we didn't finish the story. This is what the Global Surveyor's magnetometer, electron reflectometer did. But the message is the structure, the pattern there, attests to the fact that rocks were magnetized at a time when there was a whopping magnetic field that was then lost. And we have the remnant structure, the kind of fabric that we saw in the mid-ocean ridges in the International Geophysical Year, preserved on Mars at big scale. What does that tell us about this planet? We don't fully know. Lots of nice theories. About how this worked, but again, a different time on Mars. Early, warm, wet, dynamic Mars comes through with maps like this. And of course, we've also seen the sheer drama of the relief and landscapes of Mars. This view, actually made exclusively by laser altimeter measurements, shows the Valles Marineris. And I show it because imagine a canyon system that rips apart the shallow crust of our planet that would run from Washington to Los Angeles. I mean, if any of you have hiked down the Grand Canyon on mules or by foot, foot is better for me, but the mule riders too, you'd realize that that little canyon would fit in the smallest spot in that canyon. So the stresses and tensions in that Mars crust reflecting the interior and history of that planet are bigger, more dramatic on Mars. And of course, we've all seen our favorite biggest mountain in the solar system, the famous Olympus Mons. And you start to think about this single mountain, something like 6 million cubic kilometers of lava. It is so heavy, in fact, it's foundered on it, under its own weight, cannot be self-supported by mass because it's heavy stuff. And we wouldn't have thought to look for that kind of thing until we saw Olympus Mons. We now realize many oceanic region volcanoes on Earth have the same effect off Hawaii, La Reunion, the Canaries, the Azores. These islands all have massive slump failures, flank collapses that we didn't even realize existed. And I like to tell people, so why is this relevant? I'm worried, folks. I really am for life here, because if a sectoral collapse occurs in the Canary Islands, we will see tsunamis on the east coast of the United States. Tsunamis, 30 feet walls of water. That's going to happen. It's happened throughout history. I've seen the wrecks of tsunamis in the Caribbean on islands where they're uninhabited. You see rocks 50 feet off sea level. How did they get up there? You try to ask. Well, this little volcano, actually pretty big, volcano on Mars, helped us understand that. And then there's, of course, the evidence from cosmic collisions on Mars that were actually releasing the squishy stuff, the volatiles. And so I like to show this picture of the famous crater Korolev, named for the great Russian rocket scientist from the Ukraine. Down in the middle, that's the crater Korolev near the North Polar Permanent Cap. This big mound in the middle where you see the shadows around, we think may be an ice sheet buried by dust, recording, like the ice records on Earth, that we see in large lakes, Crater Lake, Lake Bosumtwi, we see it on Mars. And you see the fabric of the laminated or layered terrain on Mars there. And of course, we also have the CO2 frost on a crater up near the north. So we have on Mars all the right stuff, the water, the climate, the energy of the interior, all working together. And then we discovered in 2000 with a press conference, pretty unprecedented for space science in NASA other than by Hubble Space Telescope, the gully systems on Mars. And this finally brought Mars out of the dark ancient past into the modern. And there's a view very heavily stretched in the upper left of one of the gully systems in the high latitudes on Mars discovered by the Global Surveyor. When the person who did the work to discover these first saw those pictures, he called me at home, Mike Malin, said, Jim, I don't think I dare show these. Because he found a few, and he said, you know, I know the skeptics are going to say, oh, you know, it doesn't mean anything. They're all dry avalanches, blah, blah, blah. But I don't think they could be. And so he showed them to a few of us secretly at a lunar planetary science conference. He said, I got to wait. I'll get laughed at. And we all said, Mike, you're a pretty smart guy. Don't worry. But, you know, he prevailed, and 6-7 months later, came out with a paper on the cover of Science that talked about what these things may mean. They're part of the modern record of the release of materials, both dust and we think fluids, like water, onto Mars. And you can see me there in different places where if you think these things are rare, they're not. This is the gully systems on the island of Surtse, the newest land on Earth, off the coast of Iceland. We've gone there a few times, kind of cool. And you see active gullies and mud flows there that erupt from a fresh volcanic system in the same physics as we think is happening on Mars. Now, back when Mike and his team, Ken Edgett, and he first published the picture up on the left, there were maybe 100 of these things scattered around particular places in the mid-latitudes. I won't show you the map now because there's too many dots on it. Today, the census is that there are tens of thousands of these things, several of which we've watched erupt during our time. And then there's this picture on the left. Little-known picture of something you're probably looking, what the heck is that? The Global Surveyor discovered that back in 2003, right before we landed our Mars exploration rovers, and the paper was written for the journal Science by Malin and others, and basically that is a fossil river delta. Now, why is that important? We all love river deltas. The Mississippi is really cool. Indus, Brahmaputra, whatever. Basically, once you see that geomorphology, that geology, it is unquestioned, at least in the eyes of geologists, I will say, that there must have been a standing body of water to actually form that kind of topology. And on the left, on the right, I mean, my left, your right, is the Dasht al-Kavir fossil river delta in the Great Salt Desert of Iran. We have these on Earth. And so what does that mean? Standing bodies of surface water on the planet. That would have been heresy in 1978, 1980, 1990, to think that we would have evidence this strong. Of course, we see it in the minerals too. I'll get to that. So this was big stuff. The other thing we started to think about is rocks made in a situation where there is water and then it disappears through evaporation or sublimation. And on Earth, we have these weird-looking things on the right. You see what looks like a Halloween picture. It's actually part of the salt desert, where we've had evaporation producing these surface evaporites, evaporated rocks that have minerals that we can see. And on the left, you see the most active freshwater source on the Earth, which has Mars temperatures. This is Don Juan's Pond, named for Don and John, who visited it in the 1960s. Don Juan's Pond, that muddy thing beyond that dude who's walking downhill, stays wet to minus 25 degrees C. It's a hypersaline, it's more salty than the Dead Sea place, and we have found at least cyanobacteria surviving in that environment in these low temperatures on Earth. This is a protected ecology site in the dry valleys of Antarctica. So people go down there. Peter Doran from University of Chicago has students go down to measure stuff there every austral summer, and we watch the water. It's all groundwater recharge. But this is the kind of thing we may have on Mars. We found salt deposits with similar chemistry. So that brings us to the class of 03. And it was a tough year, a very good time to go to Mars. And the United States planned a pair of exploration rovers led by scientist Steve Squires and his excellent team, colleagues in Europe, including the United Kingdom, as well as our friends in Japan. And it was a tough time because of all those missions, only two of the four shown there were successful. The batting record or whatever, your scorecard for Mars wasn't good. But we fortunately hit, as I guess Tiger would say, a hole in one, or maybe not Tiger these days, whomever you choose. We basically landed two rovers on Mars in January of 2004, and one of them within a small crater that allowed us to see, in fact, the record in rocks and in soils of the past history of water. Now, in some of these places, we're talking about a place that is drier than we can physically imagine ever existing on planet Earth. It is so desiccated. It's physically impossible in the current Earth conditions to have those conditions. But on Mars, here, in that white Epsom salt-like materials we found, that's the silica one, but we've also found the magnesium sulfates on Mars, strong evidence in the chemistry and mineralogy of that stuff that water was an agent in a liquid form on the rocks of Mars in the past. This is definitive, folks. We're not guessing. I mean, CSI does Mars is true here. It'll stand the test of the lawyers. We also learned that this seemingly parking lot terrain in Meridiani Planum, where we visited for the last 6 years, is a little more hostile than we think. It's covered, and we hear the chuckles appropriately, it's covered with a thin veneer of talcum powder-like dust, more like loess here on Earth. That is something that can literally mire a 350-pound rover very easily. We've been stuck. We had 40 days of terror in the purgatory dune field and for opportunity, and now we're somewhat stuck thanks to only five-wheel drive on Spirit in another place. But this is the real Mars. A lot of the planet looks like this. Fortunately, that's actually a good thing to land on with robots and people. So these planes that seem so innocent actually contain a record at fine scale of the history of water. And an opportunity in less than 90 days, actually 45, Steve Squires and his team actually saw the signs of the record of liquid water in either the shallow subsurface or at the surface in the rocks there, chemically and in the morphology, in the shape. This was amazing. This was beyond the home run we hoped to hit with those rovers, because we went to two pretty safe places where the record for water we thought would be simply in minerals. We also saw it in the textures that you see in the pictures. And here's a place John Grossinger took this picture of the kind of setting on Earth in the Namib Desert that we find it's very similar chemically and morphologically to what we saw on Mars. So we have this stuff on Earth. Notice the backpack, not something we carried with us to Mars. Would have been fun. We've also left our calling cards. As we think about Mars as a place where we ask, are we alone? Could it have been alive? Is it still alive? We've left the puckered heat shield that helped carry us to the surface through its perilous descent, the 6 to 8 minutes of terror, as we've called it. Basically, entering the Mars atmosphere and landing is like bringing a shuttle back to Earth. It heats up really quickly, and then you have a shock and high G loading, and then you come through and have to figure out how to slow yourself down and not make a crater. We did that successfully the last three landers, and we'll talk about that. So we've made a long traverse. We went inside a crater and drove around it in earnest. We saw the rocks We see more evidence in this small crater, smaller than Meteor Crater, Arizona, of the history of water. There may have been a lake in the crater. We see that in the structure and stratigraphy of the rocks and its chemistry. And now our path continues. While Spirit is parked, turning into a landed station, after 6 years of work, Opportunity continues its trek. And in the next couple years, it may reach a much bigger crater in a different, what we think, geological unit, a different kind of rocks, if it keeps going, just on the order of 100 meters a day. So Opportunity, it's kind of like a great Galapagos tortoise as it moves. It's eking its way slowly south toward the crater Endeavor, where it hopes to see a bigger structure, a bigger section of the history of Mars. And that would be great because it may get there by the time we land our next rover, which I'll get to. So this, how to show you our self-portrait. If you were on Mars today with decent 20/20 vision, that would be what planet Earth would look like to you, when it's favorably illuminated by the sun, of course. So there you are. It's a long way home. And the question you have to ask yourself, is this our destiny? To enable expeditions ultimately by women and men here, or your children or your grandchildren, whatever, to this place where you see this beautiful picture, so you can look at home and think, boy, that's 8 to 20 light minutes away. Staggering in terms of the response. We need to learn to do that and do well. Now, while we were flying the rovers and thinking about what we really want to do in terms of asking these questions about life, we realized we needed recon. Real estate's good, but you have to check it out first. And what we had checked out only went so far with the Global Surveyor and the Mars Odyssey. So we put in place the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter, and MRO to all of us acronym fans. Now, why does this matter? Because this brought the scales of Mars to human scale, both chemically and in terms of appearance. And MRO was designed to do that while also finishing the job of looking at aspects of climate in the subsurface. MRO's been flying since it launched in 2005 and has been at Mars through a couple of Mars years now. It's coming into an extended mission. Spacecraft has a wingspan as wide as this room to provide the power, solar power, to enable its big instruments, including the highest resolution camera ever flown. Here's a nice little picture that will show that we can actually watch ourselves moving on Mars now. We can see the footprints or the wheel tracks of what we've been doing with our rovers. We can look for the crashed, failed landers. We're still doing that for some of our friends from the Soviet Union who crashed several missions on Mars, as well as our failed Mars Polar Lander. Still haven't found all of them. But we've been able to actually now link surface measurements to orbital measurements. And that is the beauty of recon. And so one of the things we've learned about Mars is it is more dynamic than we think. And that raises issues about releasing stuff that may link to the history, or not, of life. So here is just one piece of the record of now more than 100 recent small asteroidal or meteoritic impacts on the surface of Mars. And these things have been discovered through the 1-2 punch of a large field of view camera and a super high resolution 30 centimeter per pixel. That would be illegal to take pictures like that of planet Earth, according to the current space use laws, except for security purposes. But we're doing that to Mars because, you know, the laws don't apply to a planet where we don't think anyone's living. So we've been observing these active events, including, if you see here, the two left frames show pictures from our context camera taken about a month apart. You see that black smudge down to the middle right, and there's a super zoom-in view from our high-rise camera, the People's Camera, showing you a fresh crater. So we've counted more than 100 of these. There's probably on the order of 1,000. We're just not watching enough of Mars. Each one of these produces ejecta and materials that are basically sent into the atmosphere. What are those materials? What if they impact into ice? That's a thought. We've also watched what we believe to be dust and perhaps triggered by release of volatiles, avalanches off some of the polar layer terrain. This is Mars living and breathing as we watch. We've also seen what we think are jets of basically activated carbon dioxide emanating from cracks in the South Polar Cap. The cover of carbon dioxide there releases the gas after it's been entrapped. It goes from solid to gas. It's released in jets. You see the pattern of these things. This is controversial stuff, but gases are being vented from the Mars subsurface into the atmosphere. Now, what does that mean? We'll get back to that. But it's important about thinking about that. Now, we've also watched, in the example here, active eruption of gullies with very strong evidence. I can't say it's incontrovertible, you know, it's not unassailable, but evidence of the kind of geology that suggests that liquid water, or at least a Newtonian fluid, could be something else, is erupting in these places. And there's now been several of these detected in the last 10 years. This is evidence of an exchange of water in liquid form from the shallow subsurface of Mars to the surface. Could these exchanges be linked to the occasional blooms of Martian life or not, is a question we ask. Here's an example of one of the latest ones. This is a new recently activated one. The latest suggestion is this was one that was covered by dust that's been unburied now, hasn't actually flowed recently, but certainly in the last few million years, it could have erupted, producing these fan-like deposits, just like you see on hill slopes in the desert after it rains. And of course, a lot of things we see on these high-resolution views of Mars suggest things are moving around and changing. Now, why is this important? Why do we care? Because the more dynamic Mars is, the more interplay there is between what's underground and the atmosphere, the more possibilities of refuges, niches, for what we would call life. And we didn't know any of this during the era of the Vikings. And now it's emerging that there's all these things. So I like to show this slide. It looks pretty boring, I know. The one on the left shows landscapes that many scientists in the Mars community believe demonstrate evidence that it rained. Not now. We know it sort of frosts now and sort of snows. But now, in these pictures, and there's many like this from the high-rise camera system here in the Mojave Crater, is evidence in landforms that it rained. That is, the precipitation of liquid, likely water, onto the ground producing landforms. And on the right, of course, is a colored view showing the mineralogical evidence that we had these fossil river deltas. And there may be more. Again, standing bodies of water. These things suggest that we have, throughout the history of Mars, evidence of liquid water, which of course may be an ingredient for life. The other revolution, and these pictures may not look like much to many of you, but they're actually staggeringly important, and I won't show you them all. We've actually put together a new stratigraphy of Mars based on the minerals of the planet, as measured through a high-resolution hyperspectral imaging spectrometer, a lot of words. Basically, we can read the record in the rocks through their spectra from the visible through the shortwave infrared. And by doing that with the instrument built at the Applied Physics Lab, led by Scott Murchie and others, we've detected these terrains, which have minerals that on Earth only form in the presence of liquid water. And now we see on the order of a dozen of these new kind of places. The Mars that we thought in the early part of last decade would not have been so hospitable to us learning is now emerging differently. We want to go to these places, and the next big mission of the service will. We've also seen evidence in what seems to be a red-colored mid-latitude Mars of the evidence of undersurface ice. The ice tables on Mars may be very shallow. When we talk about using resources on another planet, Mars may be the best place to go. You know, we eke out hoping for 1% of water stored in these very exotic lunar soils at the polar regions, which we're discovering with the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. On Mars, when we're talking about something where 50% of the ground is water. So 1% versus 50. You know, you can do the economics. It might be a little easier to live where there's more. So let me move on. the other thing, of course, is we've discovered things we always hoped to find. We've discovered these pits. These are basically the exposed holes of lava tubes where liquid rock flowed. This is just one of the beauties discovered by the high-rise camera, seen in the context image on the left. And these places could produce microenvironments underground that would produce warmer and potentially wetter situations that could be the kind of places, if you were an Earth-like critter, you'd want to live if you were on Mars. Now, remember one thing I told you at the beginning. Mars lost its protective magnetic field. So when you're on Mars now, you're not just getting a suntan. You're being bathed in the background cosmic radiation of our universe, the solar proton events that stream off the sun during solar max, and coronal mass ejections, and the ultraviolet ionizing radiation that's part of not having an atmosphere that's absorbing all that stuff. So it's still a challenging place to eke out a living. Underground may be better. And of course, we have to show the gallery of where we've seen. There's Earth and Mars, Earth and the Moon, seen from Mars. So if you were there with a big high-powered camera, you know, big long 5-meter focal length thing, that's what you'd see. So we've done a lot on Mars, and one of the things we realize is the poles are really, really cool. I don't mean that just to joke. They are a key element of a climate story on Mars that is a lesson for Earth. Mars' rotational axis doesn't wobble a few degrees, which has been humongously important in the record of climate change on Earth. It wobbles tens of degrees on timescales of less than a million years. We see that in the record of these polar caps and in the views we can synthesize of them ever-changing. These are the tree rings of Mars in terms of climate. And going to those and extracting the records chemically and morphologically is really an important thing. See how climate change may work on another planet as we compare it to our own. So we actually used that record, and this map is pretty boring, but it shows all of the high latitudes of Mars and the blues below may be buried ice sheets. We landed Phoenix, as I'll get to in a second, and we demonstrated that. And the other thing shows what radar shows you in places where there are patterns in the rocks where there may be enrichment in minerals that could have also connoted the history of water. So given the story from Odyssey about these huge signatures of potentially shallow water ice, we sent a lander to Mars about the size of a coffee table, openly competed. I like to tell the kids, if you like the Olympics, we did the Olympics Does Mars to pick this mission. We had 25 missions and made the best woman or man win. The Phoenix mission won, successfully landed on Mars in the high latitudes, developed by Lockheed Martin in Arizona and JPL. And it basically asked the question, as you can see in the map, can we land in a region where there ought to be ice under leg, I guess I would say, and can we study that ice by actually tasting it chemically? We hadn't done that before. And a lot of people, you know, it's the old Judas thing. They don't believe you until you've actually touched it and measured it with a system that says, yep, that's that molecule, no question. So we went there, and very quickly in the mission, even though it was a lot harder to dig in this extremely frozen, talcum powder-like Martian soil, we saw evidence spectroscopically and through a mass spectrometer there is water ice underfoot. We measured it, tasted it, even discovered other chemistry in it that's rather challenging, these so-called perchlorates. But the Phoenix mission was dramatically successful for 150 days, really probing the chemistry of the real Mars. So where are we with Mars? We've had a decade that is unprecedented in the exploration of another planet. We really have. It's a tribute to the trust of the American taxpayer and everyone that we've been able to fly these missions. Four of them still operational, the two rovers, Odyssey and MRO, and soon to be followed by the big sister, Mars Science Lab, and a little sister known as MAVEN to study how the atmosphere is actually shedding material. And beyond that, we are going to engage in the most, I think, the most exciting partnership with our friends in Europe, in the European Space Agency, on an integrated program of Mars exploration that could culminate in getting people to Mars. Now, why are we doing that? Because putting the best minds of at least those spacefaring nations together, Europe, Canada, the United States at least, and also partnering with Japan, we think we can make further progress. Because Mars is getting hard. One of the big discoveries in the last few years has been the detection of the trace gas methane. Okay, you've all seen the methane jokes from the cows. When cows vent gas, they produce methane. That's a joke, folks. Sorry, I know it's lunchtime. But anyway, methane also burns. It would be great rocket fuel. It also is a biogenic trace gas on Earth. When things die, they leave behind an imprint that can then generate methane. We've found places on Mars from Earth-based telescopes suggest spatial variation of methane at parts per billion. This is not an abundant trace gas or climate relevant gas, but it's there. We think that's true. In places where there's a story on the right from the geology that suggests, wow, are we exchanging reservoirs from the shallow subsurface where there could be living things with the atmosphere? Or are we not? And a nice figure from Sushil Atreya suggests there's lots of ways to make methane, CH4, on Mars. And we can't be so bold as to say we know, but it's worth finding out. Because if it is a biogenic trace gas, that would make evidence of active biological processes of an Earth style ongoing on Mars today. And certainly in the subsurface, you'd be shielded from radiation. You could be warm. You could be wet. All those things are starting to come together. So one of the things we'll do with our friends in Europe is fly a mission to probe the atmosphere to look for signs of those gases. And then while we're planning that, we'll turn to our next step. And a lot of people have asked, so how are we going to look for life on Mars? Viking was really tough. We went, we thought simple Earth, you know, chicken soup-like experiments were going to work. Best minds put them there, and they didn't. Mars was tricky. Superoxidants and other things came to bear. So we're going to go and look for the building blocks of life in the chemistry with a rover about the size of a Mini Cooper or a VW Beetle. Any of you have a Mini Cooper or a VW Beetle? Just checking. Okay, so imagine carrying 40 pounds on in your trunk, which makes basically 2,500 watt-hours of power continuously for the next 87 years. Wouldn't be bad. That's how we're going to fly the Mars Science Laboratory. And there's the Rogues Gallery out at JPL, the little Pathfinder Sojourner rover we flew in 97, the Spirit and Opportunity rovers there in the middle, and our big sister, the Mars Science Lab, with its massive 6-degree of freedom arm, its instrument inside called SAM that can measure parts per billion of the chemical building blocks of life, including even the noble gases that will tell us how the atmosphere is working. That experiment package being built right up the road in Maryland at Goddard is more powerful than the spectrometers that we had in labs here on Earth when the moon rocks came back. And now a robot is going to work it. Pretty cool. We've come a long way. The robots are doing everything. But it took the minds of smart women and men to actually build it and get it on the rover. So this rover has a tough job because it has to not only follow the water, one of our catchphrases, or try asking the simplest question we could Mars be alive anywhere you land? But it's got to find and follow the records of carbon, which are elusive on Mars. We have to do that in the context of a place where the record of water may have existed, and that's the kind of landing sites we're looking for. So MSL is our first flagship to Mars since Viking. Like Hubble for astrophysics, MSL will look at not the whole universe, but the local universe of Mars and ask, are there records of carbon? Is it reduced? Could that be an indicator that Mars was alive? Or are we confused, confounded, or as kids say, confuzzled by what that is? So what the Mars Science Lab, the rover's been named by a young woman, Curiosity, by the way, I think a very appropriate name. This 800 kilogram vehicle, a really extraordinarily large wheels and everything, even has imaging vision up at the top. I can't point being high challenge, but that thick thing that sticks up to 2 meters, contains a camera system which has a stereo wide-field zoom capability that is equivalent to the system that James Cameron used to film Avatar. In fact, James Cameron is involved, thanks to our administrator. We are hoping to take 3D HD movies on Mars. We can't send them back that easily. It's a long way, but we'll get glimmers of that and hope that colleagues like Jim Cameron can help do that for us. So it's one of the exciting wrinkles of bringing Mars to the people. But what we learned from MSL will help us decide behind the pathways. Is this complicated diagram of all the different ways carbon could work on Mars, Jen Eigenbrog, one of our scientists at Goddard, has been working on all the different pathways which you could have, store, and record and preserve the record of carbon made from either life or other things. Now, we found carbonates, carbon-bearing minerals. We see carbon in dust, but what kind of carbon is it? That matters. Not all carbon is alike. Of course, we're carbon-based life forms. We care. We found landing sites on Mars where the mineral records support the history of water and past environments that might have been conducive to preservation of records of life. Nanofossils, chemical fossils, building blocks chemically of reduced carbon. These are the candidates. There's actually 4 primary ones now we're looking at in earnest with the science community. This is one of them. An area called Neely Fossae. It's also a place where there may be localization of methane. The Mars Science Lab can measure methane and see what kind of carbon is in it. And that's real important. So we have places. Here's MSL, the Mars Science Lab. Sorry about that. You can notice the names of things. RAD, DAN. It's a RAD mission. Just kidding. Just a joke. We have strange names for things. I apologize for them. But this is really our flagship to open the gateways to Mars. It's a gateway mission. What we learn from it when we launch it in 2011, it arrives on Mars in the summer of 2012, will dictate the course of Mars exploration. It will be the first landed mass that's starting up the curve to enough mass to the surface of Mars to think of sending people. We're kind of heavy. We need a lot of gear. Robots, thankfully, don't need as much. So there's just for scale a great naval officer next to the MSL. The camera sits taller than I would ever be. Nice to know that. And you can see the architecture of this mission built and developed at the Jet Propulsion Lab. It's really a tribute to them to stay with this incredible design that we thought of in the fall of 2000, and they've been working since then. It's going to enter and land on Mars in a new way. We have to get more mass to the surface. So instead of airbags or simple little rockets like Phoenix, we're going to go in on a rocket-powered, well, after an aeroshell entry system like we bring back astronauts, we're then going to come in and land on what is basically a rocket-powered helicopter, which we call a sky crane. And this will allow us to winch down the rover without contaminating the site with dangerous rocket fuels, and then to allow us to conduct reconnaissance at the scale of tens of kilometers. There's the aeroshell that will bring MSL into Mars. It's big enough to carry a capsule with a person in it, if that person had all the other stuff they'd need to stay alive, which they wouldn't. But there's a car, and you see the aeroshell developed at Lockheed Martin. And so come August of 2012, we will be back on Mars big time. Stereo HD TV, the instruments that we've always dreamt to have the robots run, will be on Mars. And this is the people's rover. So get ready. Now, people ask me, so we've had a decade of Mars exploration that's unprecedented with its successes. At least here at NASA, our track record is we're batting 1,000. This is way cool. But we've transitioned from the simple question, did Mars harbor any water, to knowing Mars is a water planet, to ask, how do we intelligently, effectively, and cost-effectively ask, are there signs of life on Mars? Could we know that Mars was alive today? Or was it in the past? And if so, what happened? Kind of relevant to life on Earth. Do we want to go here? And so one of the big questions is really, where do we fit in? Are we always going to be the armchair explorers here on Earth, following the photons back and forth to Mars? Or are we going to go ourselves? And you see the record of footprints, Leah Tolle, Apollo 11 in Tranquility Base, and then Mars. And I think that question is the one that really should resonate with us all. When will we be ready? Should we? Is that expedition worthy of humanity? Because it is far. It's not just like to the moon. It is way far. So how will we go? We'll go on the shoulders of technologies. And we're lucky our administration now understands that the new technologies that will open the Mars frontier to bigger robots and ultimately to humans have yet to be developed. Look at this landing system with a large inflatable brake, basically a balut, which will slow down spacecraft that will ultimately carry people who will explore Mars possibly like this. And you see the little models we have for how humans might best explore a planet. With so much going on, we'd want to get out there and get dirty. But it's a big place. It may not be safe to get dirty. The soils may be toxic. The radiation is nasty. How we go will depend on the robotic exploration we do over the next 10 or 20 years. And so will we drive around with our Winnebago model, which a lot of us like, it'd be kind of fun. Will we commute out and back each day, kind of like the Apollo dudes did, to understand the Mars in a really hot spot? Or will we go a little and send our robot proxies off into the sunset to do the work that isn't well suited for women and men on the surface of Mars because of risk or challenge? Some of the places on Mars may be so hot in terms of possible life that we don't want to contaminate them. And human systems, unfortunately, we're living universes in ourselves. We have to bear witness to that planetary protection. We don't want to kill the Martians so that we can understand them, if there are any. All right. So Mars is a natural laboratory for us. It is a lesson plan for us to see parts of our own destiny. I do believe, as one person, that we do need to go ourselves through the eyes of our robots and eventually through the eyes of the brave explorers that will go. I made this weird slide together with my boss, Ed Weiler, a few years ago to ask, so why does Mars matter? Yes, it's a frontier. It's tangible. We can imagine being there. But why does it matter? Well, when you look at the interest, understanding, and scientific impact on the y-axis there versus where you could go to really understand our place in the universe, a big question, ennobling, you say, well, we can learn a lot about the universe from the moon. It's a laboratory. We can look and build telescopes bigger than the James Webb and Hubble to see back in time, to see other planets, and we must do that and have plans. And we can go to Mars because where that intersects that curve is stuff that matters to us. Who are we? Where are we going? Where did we come from? Are we the Martians, as Chris McKay would say? Possible. Does panspermia work? And ultimately, our destiny in the cosmos is to find the other Earths, and maybe Mars is the next best place to start that journey. So I think it all is in the hands of the kids. And here's a young chap, related, I might add, standing next to the Mars Exploration Rovers right after we landed and next to a placard at Universal Studio in California, thinking about going themselves. And that generation of today's middle schoolers or younger can imagineer going to Mars. So I want to finish with a quick movie. I think I have 1 minute. Do I? Finish with a movie, if I can cut, and take you to Mars the way it may be. And if you give me 1 second, I'll start the movie. It just takes me a second to find the movie. And here is the movie. And so, I don't need that to worry about the Java update, as much as I love Java. So this is the Mars we've come to know in 3D. And we've seen the Mars that we've seen from the legs of Phoenix. And we've seen the ice sheets. And we've seen the places we may want to go from the eyes of the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter. And ultimately, we've seen into the ice sheets of Mars from the radars on Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter. And we've seen what the Mars Science Lab may do. And this is the sky crane depositing the Mars Science Laboratory on Mars, showing the instruments that allow us to measure the chemistry of rocks without even touching them. This is CAM, a laser-induced breakdown spectrometer developed in the United States and in France. We have a drilling system to go into the rocks away from the surface cover to measure things and bring them inside the rover. This is the kind of extrusion system. There's the little pieces of rock that will go inside. You see the little thing. Go inside the rover and be prepared for analysis using very complicated gear. This looks a lot like Rube Goldberg, but believe it or not, it actually works. We've tested it at JPL. This is the delivery of the samples down into the system that will measure the new Mars, and we'll go to see what is there. There's the MSL driving off. Its surface mission is one Mars year, but we hope to run it for years. So this is the bridge. Now, I will move on quickly. Sorry, I got a little carried away. So let me finish with the following thought. This is Mars sample return. Someday, human beings will go to Mars. When that day is, I can't say. I think it is our destiny, perhaps as an international planet community, to do this. We will land on Mars in systems that weigh 10 times the Mars Science Lab, because that's what we'll need to stay alive. We'll go to Mars to a place that's been scouted by these grand robots that have opened that frontier. They're like the Renaissance explorers that opened the continent we're on. And these people that get to go will actually be conducting immersive surface reconnaissance on another world as experiments in their own right. That's what they'll be, grand experiments for humanity. And so one of the questions we have to ask is it an imperative to actually send them? Could we do it all vicariously? It really is a worthy question. I believe, and this is just a little bit of animation of what it might be like, I believe that the journey will be worth the investment in learning how to live and work in space. Becoming spacefaring is a journey. There's a woman and a man thinking about what it might look like to come in to land on Mars for the first time. Some people call the decision to make this commitment the Columbus decision. It will be of that ilk, if you map back, of course, 500 years. And what will the people do? That's a question. It's a worthy question. We think there is tons of exploring and science and living off the land they can do. And so I would like to finish with what we do. You can see them doing neat stuff. One of the things I've done in my career, I can't find the opening, sorry. Here, let's just let it go, is seek Mars on Earth. And we can learn by using our own Earth. This is Surtsey Iceland, the newest land on Earth off the coast of Iceland. It is a small island, 50 kilometers from anywhere. When you're out there, you feel like you're, you know, disconnected from planet Earth. It is still actively venting trace gases, as volcanoes do in many places, and not unique to the mid-ocean ridge. It has gully systems and scars like those we see on Mars. Of course, now there's seaweed and stuff that we would not expect on Mars. But when you look at a place, there's a gully. These are the kind of gullies we've seen on the planet Mars. When you go to a place like this and imagine what it would be like to explore a world like Mars, 20 light minutes from Earth, on your own, riding the coattails of technology. Here's the layer cake structures. We've seen these textures on Mars. We can go and actually see records in the volcanic stuff on there. So I'll finish with this. This is how we think life may have gotten started on Earth. Here's sulfur-based life forms, chemotrophic. That's my hand. It's very hot. These are the kind of geothermal systems where we find evidence of the most primitive cyanobacteria, even under 200 degrees C temperatures, like we might expect in the plumbing system of a volcano. Here in Iceland, as in other places on Earth, we see in this large zone of ooze is one of the richest biota on planet Earth and the most primitive. Colonial cyanobacteria living chemotrophically with limited photosynthesis off the chemistry of volcanoes. All of these things could have occurred on Mars. There is no question. So as we think of our ladder to the future, maybe that ladder, this is the ladder to the moon painted by the great modernist George O'Keefe, maybe this ladder should change for us. So this was painted in 1958. The picture hasn't been seen in a while. George O'Keefe from her studio in Taos painted the ladder to the moon. And little did she know, in a decade, people would be orbiting the moon as an artist, not connected to science or technology. And so the question I ask, this painting is owned by the billionaire Emily Fisher Landau in New York City, great person who kept it. You see the moon she painted out of her window, and we actually went there. It was described as the engineering feat of the 20th century, notwithstanding other fantastic ones. But there's the moon. We went, we saw, we're there again with robots. What will the moon become? Is that our vision, is the question I ask you. Is that the vision for the new NASA? People ask, do we have a vision? Maybe that's it, opening that frontier to ask the tough questions and to go there. So I'll finish there, and thank you all for your time. We have a big job to do as people if we want to go. I think it's within our means and our realm and our excitement. A lot to learn on Mars about ourselves. So I thank you all for listening and take some questions. So I understand if any of you have questions, I'm all ears. Yes, sir.
Well, you said Mars lost its magnetic field. It's kind of scary since the first magnetic fields are required for our light to exist here, right? Because if don't they repel a certain amount of solar winds, things like that?
So the question is, Mars apparently had an Earth-scale magnetic field, a magnetohydrodynamo, that produces, in fact, an energy force field that screens out the nasty energy of deep space radiation, even the sum of the solar protons that are kind of nasty for astronauts up there exposed to it, and most of them aren't exposed to the full force of it. So we have a magnetic field that does protect us. In fact, it protects the Earth-Moon system in a unique way. We're studying it in earnest. Mars lost that. So when you imagine going to Mars, you're unprotected from space weather and from the galactic cosmic background that is leftover imprint of the energy of the formation of the universe. This stuff is important. When you think of going to Mars and just standing in a spacesuit and waving around, well, that wouldn't be too prudent, as you correctly said. And that's why I mentioned earlier, not one human, not one organism intentionally has been sent back to deep space. I can close this thing down. It looked kind of boring for you to see my desktop. Here, I can open up APL and run some programs. So that is a key thing. The human health and safety and performance factors, so that you and you and you could go to Mars as an effective explorer, as an astronaut, as a cosmonaut, is a very important thing. We actually have research going on an orbiter around the moon now to see what kind of radiation shielding, space radiation shielding, will we need. Because we did the calculation. If you went to Mars now in a standard space shuttle, ISS, International Space Station spacesuit, flew out to Mars 9 months, operated on Mars for a year and came back, a standard opposition class mission, as they're called. Every single cell in your body would be traversed by multiple high-energy particles associated with space radiation. And you can do the math. Trillions of cells, every one impacted by that kind of radiation. And the probability of you coming back as you left is pretty small. So we need to think, what do we do to shield ourselves? Even the fastest trip to Mars could take 3 or 4 months if we had more energetic propulsion. So there's a lot of hurdles to going to Mars, but they're worthy hurdles. We had the same scale of hurdles when we went to the moon. And when President Kennedy said we choose to do these things, not because they're easy, but because they're hard. And going to Mars will be hard. I'm not saying that just in jest. That challenge bore fruit as NASA went to the moon. And the legacy of the moon program actually carried us to robots on Mars with Viking, using heat shields that we learned to use to bring people back from the moon. So I think you're absolutely right. Mars is now unprotected in the solar wind, in the background cosmic radiation. So when we go, we'll have to be smart. Maybe we will be telecommuters, living in our protected habitats, sending out robots to fetch things for us, going out for brief forays, and coming back with specially protected suits. These are questions we haven't answered, but I think they're answerable. Yes, sir. So you had two excellent questions. One is, what about the history of the Mars atmosphere? Is there any, what is the state of knowledge of its possible blow-off from large cosmic collisions? And secondly, is Mars an ultimate destination or just a step, you know, if you will, a stepping stone in the way to go further? So let me answer the first one. We have a mission known as MAVEN that will be launching in 2013. That mission will investigate the materials that are being shed presently from the Mars atmosphere and the energetics of those, the chemistry, the particles, and in a very elliptical, unique orbit. It will actually measure the history of the Mars atmosphere from the isotopes of the materials, the energy of them, and do it for a full Mars year, attempting to look at the question, did Mars lose and then replace the atmosphere it was born with or that it came to be born with? And that's a fundamental question. We don't know what we don't know, but we suspect that these giant cosmic collisions that formed basins on Mars as big as Australia could have removed most of an early Mars atmosphere and allowing it to be replaced with an atmosphere today that's it's mostly carbon dioxide and argon and a little bit of water vapor. So we have a mission designed to test that, as well as chemistry on the Mars Science Lab that can also look at some of the chemical pathways. If the noble gas isotopes follow certain patterns, we can tell whether the atmosphere has been replaced or not, as we can on Earth. Secondly, Mars is of course not the ultimate destination. People want to go everywhere. The question is, where should we go and where can we go as technology catches up with our ambitions? Mars is at the limit of imagining the technology taking us there to do gainful work for the benefit of everyone back here. Having the technology to go there will help us here, unquestionably. And I can go through that if you want. But beyond is really an important aspect of this. Where else do we want to go and need to go? And one of the biggest hurdles is the fundamental limits of physics of propulsion. So, this gentleman's been waiting.
That's exactly what I want to bring to your attention. I think the limitation behind everything is propulsion because, if the propulsion technology allows, there's supposed to be a moon around the orbit. Which one of those moons around the orbit of Jupiter that's supposed to be as large as the planet Earth that's totally water ice? Which one is that?
Well, there is a moon called Europa. It's not Earth size. It's the size of the Earth's moon. It's not totally water ice. It's ice 4 silicate, which is a very unique thing that's hard for us to imagine. The ice is harder than rock. And it's in a very challenging radiation environment thanks to Jupiter. And Europa is an important destination because it may harbor subsurface oceans. There's another question back there. Yes, sir.
I have a technical question.
Yeah. So the question is, when we land the Mars Science Lab on Mars in August 2012, the rocket-powered sky crane, sort of like a rocket helicopter, how high will it be? It depends. We have radars and lasers that tell the distance, but the optimal distance is around 10-20 meters. So we'll be winching down this 750-kilo rover on special umbilicals down that distance. So we'll acquire the terrain the same way we land and acquire terrain with robot drones now, technology developed in industry and by JPL, and then winch it down, and we have backup systems to multi-sense it so we don't fail on that landing, and then we'll cut the umbilical and fly off with the sky crane, and that will allow us a much more protected landing. And the landing loads, instead of being 5 to 50 Gs, Earth Gs, will be very low, and that will be the first low G landing, really low-G landing on another planet.
What happens to the crane?
It flies off several kilometers downrange and then will crash. Its fuel will be expended at that point, so it will not be producing, contaminating with hypergolics on the surface. And that's how we impacted the empty Centaur stage with L-Cross last fall. We expended the fuel and let it hit basically dry.
Okay.
Sure.
We can take a few more questions.
Okay.
Jim will be here for a couple more minutes. And that concludes.
Well, thank you very much, folks. Appreciate your time.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.